Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for your love for us, and we pray, Lord, that you would come and be in our midst. We pray, Lord, that you would send your Holy Spirit to fill us, and pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, whatever troubles or cares that we have that may distract us, we pray that just give us strength to lay those at your feet now and to turn our attention to you. Pray that you use Pastor Izzy now as a vessel to speak to each one of us, that we be encouraged for this coming week. We ask that now in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 2. This is the little epistle near the back of your Bible. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, then Jude, and then Revelation. So if you're new, like some of these young ones, they're new to the faith. We don't want to leave them out. Don't go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. That's the other gospel, the gospel of John. These are just the little letters that John wrote. And last week we saw one of the reasons that John wrote this epistle, he said, was so that our joy would be made what? Complete or full. And we had have fullness of joy. And guys, without fullness of joy, being a Christian's a drag. I mean, there's just too many things that happen. And, you know, sometimes you'll run into some Christian. How many of you met a Christian where you're like, hey, how's it going? And they're like, rrr. And you're like, are you a Christian? I thought you were a believer. I am. What's your problem? And you're like, how's your joy this week? Ah, I don't want it. And then joy is down. The meter is pegging the zero or minus one or something. They're way down on joy. But the problem is without fullness of joy, the joy of the Lord is our what? It's our strength. And you know, sometimes when we focus on our circumstances, it's really easy to lose our strength because we can lose our joy right away. But see, the joy of the Lord comes from not focusing on our circumstances. Instead, it comes from focusing on who? On Him, on the Lord. When we put our eyes on the Lord, He never changes. He's always there, steadfast, no matter what our trial is. So when our focus is Him, all of a sudden, our joy isn't dependent on our circumstance. Our joy becomes dependent on our relationship to our Maker. And if you really want to experience fullness of joy, I've noticed that some of the, what I call the seasoned Christians, the mature ones that have walked many a day with the Lord, they have this ability that no matter what the circumstance is, they still have joy. I mean, they could be having a crummy, I mean, talking about bad stuff happening in their day, and you're like, how can you be so joyful? And it's not because their focus is on their circumstance. They learned a long time ago, that's not the source of our joy. The source of our joy is the Lord. And our relationship with the Lord. And how much does the Lord love us? Does His love ever waver? Does it ever change toward us? No. And this morning, we're going to continue on in the epistle of 1 John. As we see, John told us last week that it doesn't matter what our sin is. How much sin can Jesus' blood cleanse? All. And when we remember that, This is, by the way, the first source of our joy comes from the fact, how much sin did He forgive us? All. You know, sometimes we just need to go to church and hear, man, your sins are all, everyone free. Because we might have got beat up by our sin this week. You know, we might have had someone throwing it in our face. Man, you're a sinner. I'm thinking, yeah, why do you think I signed up for this club? By the way, if you're perfect, you don't need to stay. You're not going to get much out of this. But the rest of us, the Bible says, how many have sinned? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every one of us has sinned. And when we recognize that we've all sinned, then we come to this really sweet understanding. We need someone to do something about it. And the reason we have fullness of joy is because Christ did something about it. And John, he's going, guys, let me tell you. Let me tell you these things. Let me write to you these things so that our joy can be complete. Now, as we go through this epistle, there are so many sweet things in this. I'm going to have to break it down a bit. But today we're going to come to verse 1 of chapter 2, where John is going to say, The second reason he's writing, not just that we have fullness of joy, but I want to show you this. In verse 1, if you'll look on with me, it says, "My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not," what? Sin. What? He's writing to us so we may not sin. Now, this is one of the things that, well, he writes, if we do sin, if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He himself is the propitiation of our sins, and not for ours only, but for those of the whole world. Christ has paid propitiation. We don't, any of you use that in a sentence lately? Yeah, propitiation. I use that all the time. Nah. There's a lot of Christian lingo that you got to learn. You know, we should get an extra degree. Christianese, it's like an extra language that you learn when you become a Christian. There's all these words, sanctified, consecrated. Use that much in a sentence lately? Not me, but these are words that have great significance. Because what does propitiation mean? He was our propitiation. What does that mean? It means he was our substitutionary payment. He stepped in. If I wanted to pay for my sins, it would have cost me all my blood. The Bible says the life is in the blood. But the wages of sin is what? Death. And if you want to pay for death, you got to pay for it with life. And that's what Christ did. He shed his blood. That's why we sing all those hymns, you know. What can wash away my sin? What's the answer? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. See, what can make me whole again? With nothing but the blood of Jesus. You can't be whole without the blood of Jesus. And I know a lot of teachings today that say, oh, pastor, don't talk about the blood. That's gory. I'm like, what? Are you kidding me? We just studied last week. In Isaiah, though our sin be as scarlet, he makes it white as what? As snow. You know, one of the things that's so encouraging to me is knowing what the Lord did to forgive my sin. He went to great lengths, and it cost God the greatest payment you could possibly give. He gave his only begotten son. You know, when people say, how much did it cost for your salvation? It was a dear price. I mean, if you ask me, give up my son, Daniel? The Bible says, for a good man, some might even die. You know, you might lay down your life in exchange for someone that's good. But how about for a schmuck? You know, how about for a jerk? How about for a thief or a murderer? An insurrection? How about for someone who's just absolutely perverse and horrible? If you said, pastor, would you let your son die for that perverse, horrible person? No, my answer would be, let them die themselves, man. I'm keeping my boy. You know, I don't want to give up my boy. He's my boy. I wouldn't want to give him up for some bag. But see, this is what God did for us. He gave up his own only begotten son because he loved us so much. And that, by the way, is really good news. Now, this is something that John says, I'm writing these things to you. And I like how he opens chapter 2 because he says, I'm writing to you, my little children, so that you may not sin. By the way, this is a huge revelation, at least it was to me as a new Christian, that I may not sin. Like, by the way, I don't know about you, but before I was a Christian, I never woke up and said, hey, I wonder if I may not sin today. Oh, I never did, could I not sin? It was more like, which sins am I going to do? And how many times am I going to do it? You know, like I would be plotting from the moment I woke up. You know, it's just the way the mind works of the fallen man. It was like, okay, that guy did me wrong. I'm going to go get revenge on him and that person. And, oh, and that cute girl over there, I got to go say hi to her. And, you know, there was all sorts of thoughts, but they weren't like, I'm not going to sin thoughts. They're more like, how many and how often? And John says, I'm writing to you so that you may not sin. What? Have any of you ever entertained the idea that you might not sin? That what Christ did for you was to free you from sin? He didn't just pay for the sins you committed. Now, John's going to explain, if we do sin, We have, here's another Christianese lingo, we have an advocate. Now, some of you might have used that if you're around courts. You know, maybe you're in the judicial system. What is an advocate? For those ones that don't know, what's an advocate? It's literally a defense attorney. You know, the one that defends you before the judge. Now, we're told in the scripture, if we do sin, we have a defense attorney. Who's our defense attorney? Jesus. And who's the judge? God the Father. Just picture in your mind a courtroom where God's behind the, you know, the big lectern-looking bench there, you know, and he's got the gavel, and then we're brought before him with our sin. Says if we sin, we got to go to court for this. We stand before God for our sin, but when we go, who goes with us as our defense attorney? Jesus, our advocate, goes with us, and the Father says, "What's the case now?" Oh, by the way, who's the prosecuting attorney? Satan. That jerk. I can't lie. He's in the scripture. I'll show you just quickly. Revelation chapter 12 tells us that in verse 10 it says, "Now I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of the brethren who has been thrown down, for he accuses them before our God day and night." Jerk. But it says they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony and because they did not love their life even unto what? To death. And by the way, these are the three keys of an overcomer. If you ever feel like the devil's whomping on you a little and you need to overcome him, remember, it's the blood of Jesus first. You need his blood, the blood of the Lamb. And the second thing that you have that's a tool to overcome the devil, and every one of you have this, is called the word of your testimony. See, the devil can't argue what God is doing in your life, because that's what he's doing in you. He loves to argue scripture. He'll get people like, he even did this to Jesus. He threw it up and said, "Does not the scripture say? Is it not written?" The devil, do you think the devil can't quote scripture? I'm not saying he does a good job. He twists it and pulls it out of context and gets people in trouble with his quotes. But he can't argue what God is doing in you. That's your testimony. What the Lord has been doing. See, your testimony is simply, here's where I was before I found out about the blood of Christ, and here's where I am today. Maybe your testimony is like some of the new believers that just went forward in the Harvest Crusade. Your testimony might be, I was in sin, and some friend drugged me to the stadium at AT&T in Texas there, and this guy got up and told this message about Jesus, and my heart was just new. Like it was like someone was tugging me. Go up there and get saved. That might be all they have. Is that their testimony? Yes. And the devil hates it when you hold on to the word of your testimony, because he can't argue with you about it. It's your testimony. You can tell him, shut up, man. I'm just a work in progress. We're all works in progress. But the word of our testimony is that there is a God working. And the devil hates that. But see, you want to overcome the devil? Let God work in you. And people will see, wow, look at what God's doing. I mean, he's changing that person. That person has changed. And those of you that are honest with yourself, you know, how many of you experienced change, what God has wrought within you as he has worked in areas that maybe you didn't even expect him to work on? I mean, he's worked on refining you in different ways, and because he's a God at work. And there's one more thing in our arsenal that helps us overcome Satan, that stinking devil that accuses us every day, every night. Do you know that? See, some people think he's in hell. That's wrong. They need to get their theology from the Bible. Where is he standing right now? He's standing in heaven, and who is he trying to prosecute? Us. He's good. Did you see Izzy? Look at that guy. Sinner. sinned again. Thought a bad thought. You know, Jesus said, if you even think of your brother, you know, you think, I'm mad at that guy. That guy's a fool. In Hebrew, it's raka. Means empty head. Empty-headed. Fool. If you just think that against your brother, Jesus said, it's like you've done what? You murdered him. If you look on a woman, it says, with lust in your heart, it's like you committed what? Adultery. The Lord looks at the, I mean, we're talking on the inside. Not the, you say, but I didn't kill the guy. I didn't commit adultery with that gal. Jesus looks straight through all the baloney. You can fool everyone, but you can't fool God. And he sees down to the heart, the issue of the heart. And the devil, he's up there going, did you see Izzy? Look what he did. But I have an advocate. I have a defense attorney. And you know what my defense attorney does? When I am dragged before our Heavenly Father, the true judge, and accused by Satan, Jesus steps up in front and says, let me handle this one. I don't have to handle my own case. Jesus handles my case. Jesus goes, I got this. Your Honor, objection. He says, what's the objection? I paid for that already with my blood. And our Heavenly Father, you know what he does? He takes that gavel, case dismissed, throws it out. Next, but you know what kills me? Does the devil quit? He goes, that's it. Didn't get Izzy this time. Art. How about art? You know? Or, I mean, doesn't he doesn't quit on any of us. How many of you felt like the devil's been accusing you this week? Just working on you. You know, he's just trying to trip you up. Let me tell you, John says, I write this little epistle. If you don't remember anything else from this sermon today, please remember you have an advocate, a defense attorney, Jesus Christ, the righteous, who stands before God on your behalf and says, I got this. Because the devil likes to work over people. He likes to make them feel terrible. He likes to condemn. Jesus said, I did not come to condemn anyone. Right? Isn't his words, I did not come to condemn, I came to what? To save. If you feel condemned, let me tell you, the source is not God. Some people say, oh, I feel like God's condemning me. No way. Wrong, boo. There's only one condemner of the brethren, one accuser. That's the devil. He will accuse you night and day. Now, I'm not telling you that the Holy Ghost will not use a different C word, not condemned. What word does he use to tell us we have sin? Convict. This is more Christian lingo. He convicts us concerning our sin, and the difference is, it's interesting, conviction and condemnation, they both point out that we have sin, but they have two completely different reactions in our being. When we're condemned, we feel driven away from God, not worthy. When the devil whips on us a bunch of condemnation for our sin, we feel like, I can't do it. I might as well just... Here's one line I might have heard it in my own head, but I've heard it repeated enough times I can tell you. Pastor, I'm not even worth being a Christian, man. I blow it all the time. I should just quit. You don't even want me to come to your church. Really? This is not a museum for the righteous. You know that, right? Church is a hospital for the sinner, the sick. This is a place where people who are spiritually in need of a great physician for their soul to come. Jesus came to doctor you up. And Jesus will show you that you have sin. Through his Holy Spirit, he'll convict you. But the difference between him pointing out your spirit and the devil pointing out your... I'm sorry, him, his spirit pointing out your sin and the devil pointing out your sin, the devil condemns you. He says, you sinned! You blew it! And he tries to wedge this thing between you and God and drive you away. But the Holy Ghost says, you've sinned, you've blown it. And God wants you to bring that sin to him. He wants you to get forgiven for that sin. And the Conviction, even though it starts with a C, just like condemnation, it does completely a different thing. They both point out sin, but here's the difference. Condemnation drives you away from God. Conviction does what? Reunites you with God. It brings you back to God. That's what the Holy Ghost, when he convicts me concerning my sin, he's like, hey, you're blowing it. But he's not trying to drive me from God. He's trying to say, hey, let's let that go. Quit walking in that. Let it go. And his conviction, well, this is where I find out what John is talking about. I write to you, he says, so that you may not sin. Now, I like how the scripture puts things. In fact, this part of the sermon, I'm going to have Dylan edit it into a small devotional for the kids, because the kids have been asking me these questions. They have all sorts of questions, you know, like, how do I stop a bad habit? And that's a legitimate question, but, you know, some pastors are like, I don't want to answer that. Like, why not? The scripture does, over and over and over. You know, the scripture is beautiful when it comes to helping us to break free from sin. You know, this whole idea that I may not sin, I had to learn there are substitutions. Good substitutions. Let me just put it this way. In the Bible, when the Bible says not to do something, it doesn't say, don't do this, period. It tells you what to do instead. Like in Romans chapter 12, we read, when your enemy is, you know, doing bad to you, we're supposed to pray for them, right? And in Romans 12 it says, bless and curse not. Okay, any of you ever had someone come against you that's just really been a jerk, what do you do for them? Well, the Bible says, instead, it says even to pray for those that persecute you. You know, I was raised Sicilian. We didn't pray for persecutors. We had other ways we dealt with them, but it was sin. And that's not good. I don't boast in that, but I had to learn that there was a different way to handle these things. And when it comes to breaking a bad habit, they say it's interesting. I find that, you know, all these sciences of psychology and sociology are just studies of human behavior. And you know, in these fields of study, there's a lot of, I believe there's some folks, very astute observers, that are some of the top leaders in these fields. They are able to observe human behavior. They can identify problems in people's, you know, just the day-to-day habitual things that they do. They even can write theses about it. This guy has a habit every day. He gets up, he stretches, he eats, he does this, goes for a run. You know, he has some good habits. And then this guy gets up and he doesn't do any of that stuff. And they classify all these people into different groupings. Yeah, they observe the problems, but they don't have the answer for the person stuck in them. And I found that the Bible does the same thing. It observes all the Have you ever noticed the Bible talks about all these folks with different problems? There's not like any problem not mentioned in this book. I mean, we got like David, who was looking off of his balcony one day. Remember, he looked down and saw a woman bathing. What was he doing? Lust. And Bathsheba's down there taking a bath. I like that her name was Bathsheba. It's easy to remember. I thought it was Sheba's taking a bath, you know. I don't know. Bathsheba. It's an easy way to remember. But David goes and looks, and he lusts after this. And she was married, by the way. Now, the Bible says for everything that there's an area what we're tempted to sin, there's an area like, say we're tempted to lie. Now, don't raise your hand, but if any of you have ever lied, don't need a show of hands. It's probably all of us. Ephesians chapter 4 tells us, instead of speaking lies, what should we do? Speak the what? The truth. And since we are creatures of habit, whatever it is, whatever area of sin that we fall in, you know, some people, they say, well, Pastor, you don't understand. I grew up in an alcoholic family. I am the child product of generations of alcoholics. I tell them, so am I. Except that the scripture says, do not be drunk with wine. Now, it's interesting. It doesn't just start end right there. Do not do this. Instead of, because God knew we were creatures of habit, you know what he did? He's so kind. He tells us, say we had this bad habit. We're a liar. Or we're a drunkard. Or we have other areas. We, you know, pick your genre of sin. We all got it. You know, Facebook this week, someone posted on my wall, said, don't get judge others just because they sin differently than you. Right? We all sin. The Bible says we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. It's just we might have a different area. But in every area of sin, John says, I'm writing to you so you may not sin. And this is the beauty of learning the Word of God. For every area of sin that we have, God says, look, I know you're just, God, does God not know my frame? Does he not know how we're wired? Do you think the psychologists have more knowledge of our wiring than our maker? I had a question for you. God, does he know more than they do? And you know what's interesting? The guy who knows more than they do, when he talks about us having a habit, which, by the way, like it or not, we are creatures of habit. And if you want to, when my sons ask me, I need to break this habit, Dad. I got a bad habit. I tell him, son, he wants me to, like, tell him the secret to, like, somehow, instead of doing this, you just, what's the magic secret word, password that makes you stop? He says, there is none. The Bible doesn't even teach that. You know what the Bible teaches? Instead of doing the bad habit that you do, you replace it, because you're a creature of habit. You're going to do the habit. Let's just change the habit from the bad habit and replace it with what? A good one. If you're a person given to lying, here's what God's word says in James. Instead of lying, and Ephesians tells us this too in chapter 4, speak the truth. If you're a person that has corruptible speech or unwholesome words, another translation says, Ephesians 4:29. If you have, you know, you just kind of got potty mouth. That's what it says. I'm just paraphrasing, okay? Modern day translation. Hey, I didn't grow up speaking English first. This is a weird language. You look it up in Greek and you'll find out it's potty mouth. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word, Ephesians 4:29 says, as is good for giving edification. Oh, there's another Christian lingo for you. Use that lately in a sentence. Edification. What does that mean? To build up. The building up. Only such a word as builds up that person. Don't let unwholesome things come in. Say, things that build up that person. You look beautiful today. Love your outfit. Words that build, not tear down. We need to practice. And this is what the Word of God is so superior to the psychologist, because the problems are all identified in the Word of God, but the solutions, interestingly enough, the solutions are right there in the same verses. Instead of being drunk with wine, be ye filled with what? The Holy Spirit. Don't be filled to excess with wine. Be filled with God's Spirit. You get a greater high from the Holy Spirit, and you have no downside. No puking later, no hangover, no throbbing head, right? You get the same, you get a better buzz. You know, for people, now, see, I've never been drunk, so I can't compare, but some folks I know have. And they've come to Christ, and they've been filled with the Holy Ghost, and they tell me, on their testimony, they tell me that the high that they get from the Holy Ghost is so much greater than anything they got from a bottle or anything they got from artificial stimulations of different drugs, because the Holy Spirit doesn't take them up and drop them. He doesn't take them and he doesn't charge either. You know, some of these drug habits are expensive. I was talking to Mark Potts last night. He was reminding me that, you know, in his years of drug habiting, that he said, I could have bought your house three times over. I'm like, why did you do drugs? You could have just bought me a house. I mean, and you a house and a friend a house. And instead you lost all your teeth and your health. And, you know, I admire my brother Mark because he came to the youth night, the college and career night a couple weeks ago, and he said, he told the kids, look, you want a reason not to do drugs? Look at me. Look what it's done to me. Like a living, don't go there. You know, sometimes we need, have you noticed the commercials lately have been taking these, like, it's interesting how they can do it today with the modern technology and everything, but they have this beautiful young lady, right? And then she starts using ice or whatever, and they do that time lapse. But you think the time lapse is like years and years and years, and then you find out this was only like 9 months. And she went from this beautiful, young-looking lady to what? You know, she looked like she aged to 60 or something, and not good. I know six-year-olds look much better than that girl, and they're like, that's what ice will do to you. Crystal meth. That's what it was. And Mark was just sitting there going, telling the kids, don't do this. This is what it'll do to you. All the pain and all the suffering that it's brought. And now he serves the Lord. But there's still areas. You know, I had to tell him, look. He called me last night. He's like, so you ready for the college and career study? I'm not able to come tonight, but could I listen in? So none of the kids are here yet, so I'm waiting. He goes, well, just give me the study. I said, well, I'm going to talk to him about how to break bad habits. I said, Mark, you know, you got this problem. We talked about this before, but you curse a lot. Now, Mark is raised here in the islands, and he's raised by a military father. I don't know anything about that. But, yeah, I do. But, see, the problem of being his dad was in the military and Japanese American. He swore in Japanese all the time. My dad swore in Italian. And one of the weird things about when you're a young man looking up to your dad and you hear your dad speaking, your dad spouts off a bunch of expletives, we'll call them, in a different language. It's funny how weird to me that the first words most people learn in another language is swear words. It is true. It's funny. You laugh about it, but just think about the languages you've studied. How many people have learned a swear word in another language? Some of them don't even know the language, but they know the swear words. I'm like, Mark, every time your dog does something, you get mad at it, you start swearing in Japanese. He goes, you know Japanese? I said, no, I know swearing. Don't have to know Japanese. Actually, I did know a few words, and that was the bad part, is that, man, you're picking some really choice bad words there. And you're swearing them at your dog, and you're doing it in front of my kids. And I had to, you know, the Bible says you see your brother in sin, you go to him in private. So I went to him in private and said, look, you got to stop doing this. Besides that, your own sons are watching you. And do you think that our kids are not paying attention to what we do? You can say, don't do this all day long, right? But if you do it, what do the kids see? What you say or what you do? Do as I say and not as I say. Come on. You got to live it. Some dads get really mad at me when I tell them, excuse me, but I just got to point this out. You have to live what you're telling you want your boy to quit doing this sin, but you're doing it. And you can't tell him to stop unless you stop. And he said, but I don't know how to stop. And I go, but the Word of God knows how. The Word of God says, instead of cursing, what do? Bless. Bless and curse not. Now that is something, some of you could maybe use this in your drive time. When the idiot cuts you off. And you get to practice. You're going to practice the sermon today from Romans 12. Just want you to put this into practice. The next time that jerk cuts you off and you want to curse, instead you're going to go, God bless you. You need it. You drive bad, but you need a blessing. And bless that person. Now, you're laughing at me, but you just wait till the next time it crosses your mind. Because I guarantee God's Spirit, I'm goofy enough to get up here and make you remember. This is powerful, by the way. For your spiritual well-being, when you bless someone instead of cursing, see, when you speak curses to them, do you know that as you're cursing, what does it do to your innards, you know, like your heart rate, your blood pressure, your in Italian we say agita, your ulcer, you know, your heartburn. You get ulcer. You know, when you get worked up and start cursing someone, whether you realize it or not, does it eat at you? You might think that you're really letting them have it, but who's really suffering inside? You are. And this is where we have the Word of God, so precious, saying, instead of cursing, bless them. Bless and curse not. Just say, God bless you. May the Lord bless you. You need it. Maybe that's all you'll get out, but you know what? Let me tell you, will it change how you feel? Will it change inside of you when you start speaking blessings instead of cursings? Absolutely. In fact, I challenge you today that you, as you go through this week, this upcoming week, do me a favor. Any time that you perhaps have this temptation thrown in front of you to curse some idiot or maybe family member or spouse or whoever, instead of speaking a curse, speak a blessing. That's what the Bible says. Bless and curse not. Here's your alternative. You want to break a bad habit of cursing? Pick up a good habit, start blessing. That's all there is to it. They speak a something that you just, God bless you. And you know what will happen inside of you? You'll feel a peace come over you. The peace of God, it says, which surpasses all human comprehension, will guard your heart and your what? Your mind. When you start doing the very things that are written, he's writing so we may not sin. You know, we get sucked into sin. The devil is a crafty dude. My son Daniel says, Dad, you know, I think he's a little better at this than we give him credit. He's had a lot more years of practice than we've been alive. Think about it. How long has the devil been practicing his job? I mean, we got 6,000 years of recorded history from Adam to now. 6,000. You don't think he's practiced a little on how to trip up guys, how to get them mad, how to have those things? You know, that guy is practiced. But we can practice good habits in the spirit. These are spiritually good habits I'm talking about. We can take in, you know, how many of you know that verse? Whatever is true, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, good reputation, let your mind, what? Dwell or meditate on these things. Whatever is true, whatever is right, what these things that are the sweet, good stuff. Now, some of the guys are going, but Pastor, I'm really having trouble because, you know, it says whatever is pure and lovely, and I think that means I should look at porn. I'm like, excuse me, we need to go to that scripture, read the whole thing. By the way, this is Philippians 4:8, if you want to know where this verse is found. We sing it as one of our songs. But in Philippians 4:8, it doesn't say whatever is lovely and dressed in scantily clothed or non-clothed, whatever the case may be. It says, finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there's anything of excellence, anything worthy of praise, it says, dwell on these things. You know, Paul was writing to the church at Philippi, and he said, this is what you got to do with your mind. Instead of letting your mind entertain this garbage, let me tell you, see, the Bible always puts the instead, the good habit. Here's the good habit. Instead of the lustful thought, think the good thought. You know, one brother confessed to me, he said, I really struggle with lusting and pornography. I said, you're probably the only guy. I don't know. I've never heard of this before. But since I grew up with my best friend being his dad and editor for Playboy, I might have been exposed to this before. And I'm going to give you a hint. Really, you know, I found everything that the flesh throws at us to trip us up, there's always an answer in the spirit. And I sat outside the room of my best friend's stepfather was the editor of one of the editors, chief editors for Playboy. And he had bedded a young lady, 18 years old. I was about 10, 11, in the room next door listening to this going on. And when they were done, I heard the door slam. And it was the young girl coming out of the bedroom. And I came out, and she was sitting in a heap, all ashamed and weeping and her back against the wall, all curled up in a little ball. And she's just bawling her eyes out. And I'm looking at her, and she's physically gorgeous, 18-year-old. And I'm like, are you okay? Do you need a drink of water? You know, I'm 10, 11 years old. Do you need a drink of water? Trying to think, what did you say? You know, she's bawling her eyes out. What's the matter? And she goes, he says, I'm no good in bed. I didn't please him. And I'll never be in the magazine. And I thought, honey, he doesn't even get to choose who's in the magazine. I already know that. That's not his job. He just writes the little editorials at the beginning. But he was such a liar that he would use his position. He would tell these young girls, see, I'm that. There's my name. That, you know, and he would bed them. And they would think if they slept with him that somehow that would get them maybe promotion and chance to get into Playboy. And here she is born. I'm no good. I'm not worth anything. I might as well be dead, she told me. And I looked at her, I was thinking, no, that's so wrong. That is so wrong. And I was surrounded with real carnality, folks that were living in sexual sin. And I just looked and I saw that this is really fakey. It's really shallow, superficial. That was, thank you. Superficial. The way that they look is not looking at the person for the genuine person. There's this person inside there, and she's dying. And this guy is just a pervert. And I looked, and I, you know, because my best friend, his mom, was one of the gals in the magazine, too. And one of the past Playboys, and she was different, too. And I noticed there was a great insecurity in these ladies. They never felt worthy. They never felt beautiful. And it killed me, you know. It's like, this isn't right. And when guys would say, I'm lusting after them, I was thinking, I know that girl. She's a real person. And you know a picture of her. And by the way, she doesn't really look like that. That's been made up, and she had makeup on and the lights and you know, that's what's really shocking. When you see these people in real life, like I'm talking without makeup, just fresh, just walked out of the shower, you know, or fresh, you know, bedhead, you know, the hair is all smushed up and they wake up and they are not like that. And then these guys are picturing these gals are like, you know, sexual goddesses all the time. I'm like, no, they're just real gals. But this society has made this emphasis on this shallow, superficial, outward thing to make them feel so insecure. It stinks. So when this brother said, I struggle with lusting, I said, man, I know that girl. It's so funny. He's lusting after one of the girls. I knew the girl. I'm like, she doesn't really look like that. In fact, that's a wig. She doesn't even have that color hair. No way. I'm like, yeah, it's a wig. I'm telling you. Man, I was lusted because I thought she had that color hair. I love girls with that color hair. I'm sorry, it's not that color. Oh, you ruined my whole thing. Sorry. Not really. But you know what I found? The flesh is always at war with the spirit. The guy said, I don't know how to stop lusting. I said, I do. Do me a favor. Next time you're thinking about this impure thought to that girl, the Bible says whatever is pure, whatever is right, whatever is lovely, right? Whatever is honorable. Good repute, things worthy of praise, dwell on these. You know what? How about, here's one, for the guys that are struggling with lust, let me tell you a little secret I learned. Just start praying for the gal you're lusting after. I don't mean praying that you get her. No. I mean praying for her spiritual walk. Praying for her, for all the things what she's going through. All the things she's facing. Pray for God to to help her to grow close to the Lord. You start praying for her soul. You know how you want to talk about a real quench for lusting? Girls, you can do this too for guys. You're lusting after some guy, start praying for them. For their spiritual walk to be improved. For them to grow closer to God. You pray that, what happens to your lusting? Kind of interrupts it, don't it? It's one of these things. God knew we have habits, some very bad ones, but they can be replaced by some very good ones. How often are we supposed to pray? All day, right? Without ceasing. Pray without, okay. If I'm busy praying without ceasing for these folks, how do I have time to lust? It's a really great solution. You wanna cut out your lusting? You wanna cut out your struggles with whatever sin it is? Start praying. Get so busy praying, I mean, we're going to just replace your bad habit with the true good habit. If you are a person that prays all the time, do you know how much temptation that delivers you from? Do you know how much struggles and bad habits you will be spared when you walk in that good habit of talking to your Creator all day long about whatever circumstance? Something comes up, Lord, I just pray about that. Some other temptation, Lord, I pray about that. You can really wreck the temptation when you're praying about it. I mean, it takes away all the power of that temptation, just erases it. It's like it has no power over you. But see, the Word of God was written. John was writing saying, I'm writing so you may not sin. Now, if you do sin, did he know? We may not, but we may also, what? Do it anyway. And if we do, who represents us? Jesus. He is our propitiation, not only for our sake, it says, but for the whole world. He paid for the whole world's sin. And we just need a reminder of that. Now, I'm not going to go any farther in 1 John 2 today, because there's a whole bunch of things John's going to say. Here's how we know the things that we know. And these are questions I get asked often by, well, not, I'm not going to say new believers, by all believers. They're like, how do I know that I really know this thing in the spirit? Like, how for certain, how do we know these things? How do we know if we really come to know God? Next week, I'll show you the answer to that in chapter 2, verse 3. We're going to see, well, 8 different things in this letter of ways that we know what we know. And how those things, when you stack them all together at the end, I'm going to have you maybe make little, I made these little cute, this is my graduation picture right here. It's a little graduation cap with a little square and a little, you know, tassel. I just drew one right there. And I drew one over here and over, and don't zoom in, give away my answers. But you can read ahead. Someone called me this week. I've been looking. I got 7 already. Where's the 8th one? I'm like, just keep reading. They're in there. 8 different ways you can know the things that you... And by the way, it's really good for us to know how come we know these things. How do we know that we've really come to know God? Next week, I'll show you the answer to that and a few more. And they're going to be... Your friends are going to ask you questions. You're going to find out, wow, John, you really hit it on the head. You knew what you were talking about. You told the stuff, like the important stuff, like when someone asks, how do you know this or how do you know that? And you're going to find out 1 John has so many of the answers to those things people throw in your face all the time. How do you know this? How do you know that? Right here written for you. You don't even have to study. Just got to read. Stick out. Lord, show me where they... Oh, there's another one. There's another one. By the time we're done, you will be so encouraged. And because I've told you before, but the Bible teaches, don't love God with just your heart. Right? It's not. This is not just an emotional thing. Love the Lord your God. First command is with all of your heart, with all of your what? Mind. With all your soul, with all of your strength. Love the Lord with your whole being. You don't have to check your mind at the door when you come here. And say, oh, it's just, I'm coming for emotional, lift me, pastor, move me. There's some things I want to teach you, but they're going to be right down here in the brain matter, and they're going to stick with you. Just wait till that jerk cuts you off this week. And you're ready to curse. What are you going to do instead? Bless him. When it comes time to tell a lie, what are you going to do instead? Tell the truth. When it comes to lusting, what are you going to do? Pray for them. You have things you can do so that you may not sin. Now, there's a few more to cover, but we'll go over them next week. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this sweet time we've had to look to your word. I thank you for the great testimony, Lord, we had of your word going out through the Gideon Society and the things what you have done, Lord. We're so grateful for our brothers in the Gideons. We just pray, Lord, you would direct us in what you'd have us to do this day as we continue to serve you. Lord, lead us, guide us by that anointing of your Holy Ghost. Just direct each step we take. Lord, help us that we may not sin. We ask that in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Listen.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.